Let's start with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the miracle of technology and being able to communicate with each other across many miles and vast spaces and sometimes even on the other side of the world. We are just so grateful that you have allowed us to have this technology and to learn how to use it. So we ask for your grace tonight over the technology, but we ask most of all for your anointing, that you would be with us and that you would give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and that you would be the teacher among us as each of us speaks. So Father God, we give this time to you and we're excited for what you want to do in us and through us in this coming year. And I pray all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So those of you, some of you, you see a little button over on the bottom on the right that says reactions. If you click on that, there's a thumbs up, there's a clapping. Where is it if you want to raise your hand? I thought it was there. You can raise your hand. Somewhere.
It should be over on your side panel where it says participants.
Oh, I'm just not putting that up on this. Oh, I see. It doesn't show on.
Right. It's showing it.
Yeah, so if you click on participants, you should be able to see a paddle there that you can raise your hand if you have a question or something. So we want to keep this as interactive as possible. And tonight, mainly what we're going to do is we're going to have everybody go around and introduce yourselves, say where you're from, what's your connection with Good Samaritan, and what is your hope? What do you want to get out of this level 2-3 class? And some of you, especially those of us that are in this room, I've already been in level 2 for a while. We've got some interns here, but we all need to get to know each other a little bit better. So, and I think, did all of you receive the materials for the class? I sent out trainer manuals.
Yes.
Rich, you did them?
I did not. I just got the like a attachment that had the dates on, but I didn't get a manual. I got one for the level 1 on Monday, but I didn't get one for level 2, a manual.
Okay, and Christy, did you? Because I know you guys were on my mailing list.
No, I got the same thing Rich did, kind of the schedule, but that was it.
Okay, well, I'll try and remember to send that out because I'm leaving in the morning and I won't be back till Monday night. So I'll try to remember to do that before I leave here tonight. Anybody else that didn't get the training manual for level 2?
I didn't either.
Can one of you get the clipboard and kind of make notes for me? Who needs what? And I need someone to take the clipboard and check in people that are online. Yeah, just find a sheet over there. Yeah?
I got all the material. Thank you.
Who said that?
Suzanne.
You said you can hear now?
No, they just got it.
Okay. So let's start with introductions, and I think most of you know who I am. There's a few of you here that maybe have seen me or heard me teach or gotten letters from me or something. But I just wanted to share a little bit about what level 2 is and what my plan is for this year, and I always pray that the Lord directs that and changes it as needed. But level 2 is a more in-depth training, counseling techniques and methods. focus is trauma counseling. And I have been going through Peter Levine's somatic experiencing school and have found, it's been amazing. I mean, when we had to switch over to online, I was like, oh, well, shoot, that's not going to work with somatic body stuff and all that. But I was really impressed with what we were able to do online. And and learned a lot of tools that we can use in having you guys online here too. So anyway, level 2 counselor training, we're going to focus on trauma this year for the main part, but after the first of the year, we'll be doing some other things on marriage and family counseling and parenting and different, a bunch of different subjects after the first of the year. So my passion for level 2 training, I'm discovering that my passion for trauma counseling and doing this type of training comes out of my own trauma. And that the healing that I began experiencing through Good Samaritan Ministries when I started in Walla Walla, and Sheila Hare was my counselor in Walla Walla in 1991, 92. When I started the training. And she took me through some significant healing. And I have to almost chuckle because I'm in this in-depth training with Peter Levine's healing program. And what I see is that they're giving us the science behind the inner healing that we've been doing as Christian counselors for a lot of years. So it's really, they're finally getting it. It's like some of these things they're teaching us, and it's like, oh man, I can teach that right out of the Bible. And I've experienced it. I've experienced the healing, and I see the biblical connection, and I see Jesus healing trauma and the Bible. So one of the first things that we are going to go over is that foundation of inner healing in the Bible, and especially the biography. You're going to basically do a case study on Peter and learn about Peter's brokenness and Jesus walking him through inner healing as the foundation of what we're going to be doing with a lot of the somatic experiencing and trauma recovery stuff that we're going to be doing. And I'll tell a lot of stories along the way, some of them mine, some of them my clients. I've had enough trauma myself that I can just use my stories all the time, but that might get kind of boring. So let's start. Let's see. Lou, you were the first one on the computer, so I'm going to ask you to start by introducing yourself and just sharing a little bit about yourself, where you live, what your connection with GSM is, and what you want to get out of doing this online. Cool. So are you hearing me, Lou?
Better.
Lou? She's frozen.
That's good. Can you guys hear me?
Oh, no. Are you there, Lou?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're ready. You want to share with the class?
Yes. So my name is Liwana Austin, but I go by Lou. So I have been with Good Samaritan probably going on 5 years. I'm not one that does my homework. So that is, you know, I heard it takes as long as it takes. So I went to Africa with Good Samaritan in 2017. And it was the best time of my whole entire life and sparked an interest in the international work as well as the domestic work. And so I'm hoping I joined this online course because I want to connect more with everyone, not just the Walla Walla office where I'm from. So I, you know, during this season, I'm zooming it up. I want to walk alongside everyone. And that's it.
Okay. I'm trying to figure the sound out here, Lou, because you were kind of quiet. And I don't know if our... Where's Lance when we need him?
So, my sound, the sound on my end for you guys is pretty low too. So I connected a Bluetooth speaker to be able to hear you.
Is that any better?
You guys hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you. I was just turning the sound up on our speaker over here to see if it made any difference.
Okay.
Okay. So that, yeah.
I might be a level two lifer. I've been in level two for the last. Level two, three. So hopefully one day I'll finish. But in the meanwhile, I'm enjoying connecting with everyone.
Yeah. Yeah, Lou came back a changed person in 2017.
I can't wait to go again. Right. Hopefully next year.
Right. Thank you, Lou. Marion. Everybody's frozen on my computer for some reason.
Hi. I'm Marion.
Hi.
I did things backwards from Lou. I was overseas with Mission Aviation Fellowship for better part of 28 years and left them about a year and a half ago. And I've been in training with GSM in Caldwell, Idaho, not far from Caldwell in Wilder, Idaho, for the last 2 years under Angie Nichols. And I think kind of pivotal to my coming on to GSM was when I think Cindy, you came out as well as Teresa, and I got to hear from you both about GSM, and some of your testimonies really touched my heart, and I thought, well, if it's really true that you never feel like you're a counselor, then maybe that's for me too, because I have the heart desire. I just stumble over my own flesh a lot. So that's me.
Thank you, Marion. You know, I think that's true, that if we wait until we feel like we're ready, you're never going to do it. You just got to jump in and take the plunge, because especially if you think you're going to wait until you're all healed, that doesn't happen this side of heaven, you know? So I'm glad that everybody here is taking that risk. Okay, so I don't know why my computer, I'm not seeing the same thing that's on the TV. Hard. It says that my internet is unstable.
Oh, it was doing it yesterday.
Yeah, it was doing it on Monday too. So how about Suzanne, we see you on there. You want to, could you share with us?
Oh, sure. Hi, everybody. I'm from Walla Walla, and I'm an oncology nurse at Providence here. And this is my third year, so I guess I'm in level three now. I don't know. But I have been involved in a jail ministry here for women, and that was one of the things that prompted me to start with GSM a couple of years ago. So this is my third year, and I've really been enjoying it. Uh-huh.
So are you interning at this point?
No, I was supposed to last year, but it didn't happen for some reason. But I'd love to do that this year.
Well, it's been a challenge here. I've got several people that are ready to intern, but with COVID and everything being shut down so much, you know, it kind of changed all of our plans. It seems like every week I am redoing calendars and changing plans and canceling things and rescheduling stuff. and so we haven't been able to start our interns here like we wanted to too, because I didn't want to start people by counseling on Zoom. You know, I guess if you came to me and said, I really want to start counseling on Zoom, I'd say, okay, go for it. But if okay, thank you, Marion. Appreciate you being here. Rich, how about you?
I'm Rich. I'm live in Hillsboro, Oregon, so I'm not too far away. Just I am let's see here. Well, I started level one training in February. Basically my short history is that I am a retired middle school science teacher, did my 31 years in Salem. My two adult children live up here in Hillsboro, so my wife and I moved up here. We're also grandparents. And I wanted to get involved in, I've always had a passion for counseling. And I've, you know, just happened to meet a lady at our church I go to up here that said in a group, she came up to me and said, I think you would be a great counselor. And I said, well, that's cool, but you know, I don't want to go through all the hassle becoming a counselor and all that stuff. And she says, well, I'm a counselor at Good Samaritan Ministries. And she talked to me about it. And I thought, wow, that is really a great opportunity. So I started the program February, and I'm doing level one and on Mondays because I missed the first half of level one. And I'm doing this. And also I'm taking a DBT class, dialectical behavioral therapy, with Rick Collins on Thursday mornings. And I'm loving that class. That's just love it. And so I'm into this. I really want to become a counselor. And, you know, I'd like to ride off into the sunset of my life, helping people. And in a way that I'm not getting paid or have all these constraints around me like a regular job. And this is a great opportunity for me to be used by God, I think, in that way.
I appreciate it. Yeah. We need male counselors.
I noticed.
A lot of numbers here. It's, I mean, really, we do have several, we have a few male counselors, but there's a desperate need for men. To connect with men, for one thing. So, Rich, thank you for following through. We're excited to have you. And I'm glad that you're doing both level one and two so we can get you counseling. Okay, Christy, how about you?
Hi, I'm Christy Augustine. I live in Vancouver, Washington. This is my third year, and I'm super excited about it. I have been saved for 16 and a half years, but came out of some pretty dark stuff. And so it's been a long journey of healing for me and restoration. And so I had a lot of healing before I came to GSM, but in 2018, I was introduced to GSM and started counseling and found out about the training program, and gosh, was so excited I could hardly contain myself. So here I am, and super excited that this year is starting, and just really thankful for all the healing that I've received in my life and all the people that have poured into me, and know that God wants me to do that for others. So really this year I am wanting to learn to hear Holy Spirit more and just learn how God uses his love to heal people's hearts and his in their lives.
Okay. Thank you, Christy. Lorna, how about you?
Yeah, hi. I've been around GSN for years and years. My first counselor was Elsa Jane, and she was amazing. And I got a lot of healing out of that. And I have kind of, I took the level one class a few years ago and level two, maybe three. and I haven't finished up all the checking the boxes, but you can't, you know, there's never like too much of this. You learn something new every time, and it's good. We're still learning all the time.
Yeah.
Okay. And we're in the process of moving. So I'm in Portland, but I'm going to be in Coquille in, well, tomorrow probably, but we're moving soon.
And so you're going to start
going back and forth,
right?
We've been going back and forth, and we're fixing our house ready to sell and fixing our house down there. Well, sort of more just moving in down there.
So have you ever tried a counseling room in your house?
I will.
Okay.
I will.
Yeah, good. Hey, haven't heard from you yet.
Hi, I'm Gabriel Stroop. I am one of the Good Samaritan prodigal children. Many people know my mother, Teresa, is the international director there at Good Samaritan. I've spent many, many years staying away from Good Samaritan in pursuit of worldly things that we all know does not end well. I got out of the Army in 2012. I'm a combat veteran that was very broken, and both physically and spiritually, and God's been bringing me back to Him. And you know, a lot of people, some people may join these classes thinking they want to be a counselor. Some people, like myself, join these classes saying, I want to find some healing, and in turn maybe be able to help others in healing. And like Cindy was saying, sometimes there's a shortage of men being able to reach out to other men, especially in broken areas. So hopefully, you know, I'm down here in Klamath Falls, and I spent February up there in Good Samaritan, and I was taking over the center here in Klamath Falls to be the director right as COVID hit and everything got shut down. But as well as doing these trainings and finding wellness for myself in Christ, I hope to be launching Klamath Falls Good Samaritan Center again and continuing the work here in Klamath Falls.
Hey, thanks, Steve. Have we missed someone? Is there someone with an iPhone that we haven't?
Yes. I'm Ruth Ann. Can you hear me?
She's my cousin and I missed her.
Well,
it has iPhone on there and my computer isn't showing any faces, so hi there.
Hi. I am really new at this and I am not techie at all, so you guys are gonna might have to help me through this. Did I figure it out? You can hear me and see me?
Yeah, great, you're doing good.
Okay, good. I've been with Good Samaritan 2 years, starting our third year, I guess, with Marion. She's my colleague from Caldwell, Idaho. I had went probably 15 years ago to get training, or not training, but just to talk about some family issues that I had been referred by a friend. And as I walked in there, I just went, I could do this. I want to do this. And, you know, just the training and realizing that, you know, I didn't have to go through more schooling and everything, but I could get trained. And I was, but, you know, then 15 years later, here I am taking these courses, and I'm very excited about it. I really feel like, you know, when you start feeling like you're clicking with what God created you for, I'm kind of feeling that way about counseling. I had a childhood trauma, and just him and I worked through a lot of it. And so it feels right to be able to share what I've learned to other people. And so, yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
All right. Thank you, Ruth Ann. It was fun. I went to Caldwell to visit the center there, and we were meeting at somebody's house, and Ruth Ann walks up to me and is like, "Do you remember me?" Yeah, spent our summer family reunions in Caldwell, Idaho.
Yeah.
But we share an incredible godly grandmother, I think, who prayed all of us into the kingdom.
Yes, amen. That's true.
Yeah, so that was kind of fun. Related. Oh, yeah, we're first cousins.
Oh, yeah.
She's my cousin. And it was just so funny. I had no idea she was involved in GSN. And to go over and just get to see her at somebody's house, that was really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So glad to see your face on here, Roseanne. Okay, so we're going to go around the room here. And I don't know how well you can see everybody, but we're going to have each person share. And if you need to come forward, if you can't hear them, let us know, and they can come forward to be closer to the speaker, okay? So we'll start right in the front row with Melanie.
Okay, so it's who you are and where you're from.
And what are you doing? What's your connection to GSM? What's your hope? Anything you want to share, Mom?
My name is Melanie Helen, and I'm here. I'm living in Garden City currently. I'm originally from Canada, and I have family members in Canada who came to GSM to do intensive grief classes after we had family tragedy. And so I've always wanted to come. I think it's my fifth year in a class, and I'm interning with some clients, and I'm a massage therapist. I'm just running a massage business in town, talking people up.
And she's really good at it, too. Okay, thanks, Mom. Nikki. Are you guys able to hear Vicky? Talk loud.
I came to some family and they suggested a counselor. A person that I've met at other places too. And so it seemed like at this time was a time that God just said, okay, this is where you need to be. And I'm just so glad that I did. And I came in on, you know, I've already done the level one, and I went through level two, but then COVID happened. And so it's kind of like I got half of level two. And I didn't miss on the rest of it. So I'm kind of level two and three at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So yeah, Vicky's at that stage where she could be family returning now too.
Yeah.
Suzanne.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Lee. Can everybody hear me okay? I know I don't have a small voice. I have my mother's voice. I came up from the Bay Area to the Oregon area. I live in Tigard now, about 4 years ago, moved up to Tigard. I currently do part-time business consulting work in strategic planning and enjoy it. Worked a lot in high tech in Silicon Valley, and so I'm enjoying doing that. I came to GSM about 2 years ago for counseling. I discovered it online, and it was God's answer for a situation I was in. And then for years and years, even in the Bay Area, I wanted to be a counselor. I felt it was one of God's callings on my life, and found out there was a counseling program here, and got started, and the rest is history. So I completed a couple years, and kind of like Vicki, because of COVID, I'm somewhere between 2 and 3.
And Suzanne's ready to intern too.
I'm Julie. Hot to talk in this, so I'm gonna be quick. But I'm the same thing, about 2.5 years in. I grew up in the area, but moved around a few times. So I love it here. We're currently in Lake Oswego. Shortly from here, so it's nice.
And Julie's also at level 3. And ready to intern.
But homework, because I just want my kids to be officially level 3.
Yeah. Okay.
My name is Sherry Jane. I've been with Good Samaritan for, gosh, about 20 years. Grew up in this area. Grew up in Wichita High School, so we're local to this community. And I think what I find is that if you hang out long enough, you graduate here. Taking up classes, they're like, oh, look, now you're a counselor. So I've taken, the TBT, boundaries classes, Elsa Jane taught things on family, I've taken abuse recovery. And I did a lot of other counseling before I came here, and because I felt really helped and heard other places, but I felt really healed. Again, just the intensity and the ability to have that result was so much faster and so much more efficient in a Christian community and with the tools that I learned here. It's really been phenomenal. So I get excited thinking of what it's done for me, and just naturally, it's like, just want to see what else, where you go, oh, there's hope here, right? Someone else get that other.
Yeah, hope, that's what we're all about.
Yeah, it's really very much not really studying stuff.
Yeah, Sherry's ready to intern too. And Frida.
I'm Frida Emmons, and I live over in Troutdale. I've been with GSM maybe 5 or 6 years. Years ago, when GSM just started, my daughter was very young, had some health problems, and one of the founders of GSM, Jean Nielsen, prayed for my daughter. And she was healed physically at the time, but more importantly, her personality changed. She just was quite remarkable. She was introverted and scared, and now she is nothing but the opposite. She is just 100% the opposite. And it was just quite remarkable, and I just felt that God just put his hand on her, and I had wanted to come back to GSM. I live over in Troutdale, so I was in counseling for about 12 years, and I went all over the Portland area, but I didn't get over here, and I don't know why, because like Sherry, it would have happened much quicker, much more profound healing, but I didn't. But when I did come, it's like God knew the timing of my life. He knew that I had to take the steps that I did maturing before I could really be here and have this blessing come even more profoundly in my life. And then out of that has come skills that I didn't know I had and opportunities that I didn't know would even be there. It's just really surprising. The thing about counseling is I feel like if I jump in, it's almost like the first day of a job or when you're taking your driving test, I am so scared and so nervous and just think I'm gonna fall on my face. But God showed me, hey, you got through that first job. You got through that first day of every job that you have. So I know he's gonna get me through this and help me be compassionate and empathetic, able to hear someone else without being drawn in. I was afraid for years to be drawn in too far where I would hold all of the emotion from somebody else and wind up carrying that home. And I have to be careful not to do that. So I think this is going to be a learning process. And I'm anxious for it. I'm thrilled to be a part of it.
And so Frida's ready to intern too. So we have a class. We have a whole class full of interns here. And if you've picked up the most recent copy of Waiting for Understanding or Betty's most recent book, Frida is the one that's been editing those. She has gotten all of Betty's books on Amazon. Need for Understanding on Amazon now, and anyway, so I'm not sure we want her to intern because we want to use her for all of our editing stuff. But anyway, we really appreciate all this that Frida's poured into getting us into the 21st century. And your manuals tonight, you can thank Suzanne Lee, who's here in the class, for that too, because she's bringing us into the 21st century too, with technology and helping me put together the manuals so that we want to have them prepared so that we will be able to make them available to our international leaders and that they can pick up the manuals and watch the videos and then tweak the information to their culture, to their needs in their nation. So we got a lot going on over here. And I'm gonna share the screen next so all of you will kind of disappear. Because I'm gonna go ahead and share. The manual that we have, make sure that I've got it on here. I hope you don't need my emails. All right, where do we go? And I want to say, too, that the manuals are a work in progress. So I write something. I send it to Suzanne. She formats it and puts it into this document and then sends it back to me. And I give her a bunch more information and effort to it. So if page numbers are screwed up on this particular one and things are highlighted, that's because of the corrections that we're still making on some of these things. And so in the beginning we just did kind of an overview of why we need counseling. And I think anybody that's involved with the Samaritan Ministries already knows that, because most of us were pretty screwed up or broken in some way when we came to Good Samaritan Ministries. And so I share a short piece of my story of how in 1990 I was at a major crisis point in my own life, and I I've been looking for Christian counseling. And I lived in Pendleton, Oregon, and those Pendleton's 18,000 people. And it's like equal distance from the big cities. It was a 3-hour drive to Spokane, to Boise, or to Portland for 3.5 hours. And so in Pendleton, you could find pastors and some people who said they were Christian counselors, but they didn't, I think sometimes their doctrine got in the way, or their theology or their religion got in the way, and it just wasn't the depth, and it wasn't the healing that my soul was looking for. And I began to find that through Elijah House Ministries, which is located out of Spokane, Post Falls, Idaho. And they had a really powerful inner healing ministry. And so I started getting involved with them, but I mean, that was quite a trek to go up there. But I did go through all of the Elijah House basic and advanced schools in counselor training. And I really cherished the foundation I had. They have a wonderful program. But then I decided I was going to go to college and get my degree in counseling. And so I started going to Walla Walla College, and I was still working on my bachelor's, and I signed up for this class called Counseling Relationship, because I thought it would be about counseling relationships. It was on the DSM-3R, which was the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Psychiatric Diseases, and I had never heard of it. I had no clue what I was going to. Well, God put me in that class to meet Sheila Harris. And so I met Sheila, and that was 1990, I think. And she gave me an application for training in Walla Walla, and I stuck it in a drawer. And about a year later, I was in massive crisis, and I had to drop out of college. And I was so burned out. I'd been so hurt that I just felt, I won't call you. I don't care if it would help anybody in my life again, type of thing. And yet I was compelled to call Sheila, and I was calling her mainly for counseling. And so I remember telling me that it would be several months before she would get in, and I started crying. Mm-hmm. And then I told her I'd go through their training program. So she said she could fit me in. And so that began my journey with GSM in 1991. And by 1993, I opened the center in Pendleton and began a training program. Sheila had written a counselor training program from her experience here in Beaverton, and had implemented it in Walla Walla, and actually written her thesis on the parable of the Good Samaritan and the healing miracles of Christ, and setting up the counselor training program based on the principles that Betty taught here in Beaverton. And so that's where our training program started on the other side of the state. And so she set up a very solid three-year training program, which Beaverton didn't even have that. You know, Beaverton's program was very different in terms of time frame and stuff. The same type of material, and the same concepts we taught over there, but Sheila turned it into a college. I mean, you think the homework was hard. She had awareness over in Walla Walla, and those of you that are in Walla Walla probably are still going by those requirements. And ours are very similar here now. And so I took what Sheila had done and I tweaked that to Pendleton. And one of the things I did in Pendleton is I added a cultural perspective from Native Americans because of the Umatilla Indian reservation that was there in Pendleton. And so we had a number of Native Americans that went through our training, but we had them come in and do training. And how do you work with Native Americans? What's different about counseling somebody from the tribes versus one of us white guys? And it was so powerful. And of course, we had the cultural center there, the Temescal, and we would take people out, we would take our class out and go through the cultural center and have people from our class that were Native Americans lead us through that. Boy, we got some very, very unique and good education just because of where we lived and the people that we were exposed to. So I say that to say that every one of our centers has a little bit of a different flavor according to the community and the culture. You know, Pendleton was very much a cowboy culture. So we were in the cowboy parades and we used, you know, Judy Jones has had her horse towed in for many, many years, and towed finally passed away, so she doesn't have them anymore. But you do whatever it takes to meet the people you're in. So it's very different for me being in the city. And most of you know the story. Those online don't know, so I'm gonna tell it for the few that don't know. But when I took this position, I had been out of GSM for almost 10 years. And I had been working at Blue Mountain Community College, which was by the Lord's design, because at the college, I was in charge of numerous things. I started as a student advisor. I became the director of the teaching, of the training center there, and the health and wellness. And I took care of the tutoring and hiring the tutors and training them, and then all the disability services and suicide intervention. And so all of that was preparation for here. And so it was in October of 2016 I'd gone to Kenya in August of 2016 and done suicide intervention in Kenya and had presented suicide intervention to over 800 kids over there. And it was because James and Goriti from Kenya had come to the college and watched me do suicide intervention training. And they said, you have to come to Kenya. And it was one of those things that I didn't even feel like I needed to say, I'll pray about that. Because I knew it was the Holy Spirit speaking when they said that. James stands up in the auditorium where I'm teaching in the middle of everybody. But it was powerful, and it was just Terry and I went. And so it was a very unique and a healing time for me to go to Kenya. My name in Kenya is Nyarjuba, which means daughter of the village. And I feel like Naranga is my African home. But so anyway, Teresa calls me, then I came back and I met with Teresa, gave her a report, and I gave, Terry and I presented to the Kenya satellite here, as well as meeting with Betty, and so just really kind of connected back into the ministry again. And that was August, and then it's in October, Teresa called me with this offer that I couldn't refuse, you know, the offer that said, Cindy, do you ever think about moving to a city where you've never wanted to live? Taking a job with really long hours and low pay. And I just, but the Holy Spirit had witnessed to my heart, and that Kenya trip had already sealed it. I knew that I was called to be here, but I just had no clue how. And I told Teresa, I said, everything in me says yes, but I can't leave my mother. Because we had just moved her into, it was a retirement center. Because my mom was like, she was the designated driver for the Bunko group and took care of the library. And she was very much, very active. And so Teresa called me on the 10th of October. And on the 13th of October, I got a call from mom's housing place saying that they had taken her to the hospital. And 10 days later, she was gone. She died that had a UTI that had gone septic, and it was very quick. It was horrifying. It was very painful. But I was able to share with my mother that Teresa had asked me to come here, and she gave me her blessing. And to me, my mother paid the price for me to be here. And she paid the price for me to start the ministry in Pendleton, too. That when I came here in January of 1992 to my very first intensive in this very room and watched Betty put slides and pictures of Africa up on the, where, when she had just gotten back and there'd been a horrifying wreck in Africa where 8 of our leaders had been killed in a car wreck while her and Joanne were there. It was horrifying. And I was so broken at that time, and I sat through that entire weekend and I cried for 4 days straight. I couldn't stop crying. And it was the faces of James O'Keel and his family and the others in Uranga that made me ready to be able to counsel. And so God will do what he needs to get us where we need to go. And so I talked to Betty that day about starting a center someday in Pendleton. This was 1993, January of 93, and I opened the office in March. Because I had put a fleece out to the Lord and said, Lord, I need an office and I need 3 months rent and a little bit to get started on. Well, I talked to one man and he says, I got this space, and it was 3 rooms. For $300 a month. And he was the only person that I talked to. And I didn't tell anybody. And I get this check in the mail for $1,000. It was from my mother. She said, you need to start a rent. It was 3 months rent and a little bit to get started on. So I say my mother planted the seed for starting in Pendleton, and she planted the seed for me to come here. Yeah. So all of us have stories, you know, of how we got where we are. I'm just always in awe. I mean, look at us, just us. Think how complex that is, orchestrating just our lives, let alone those people around the world, you know? That somehow God keeps track of every one of us and every hair on our head. He knows exactly where we are, and he knows how to orchestrate things to bring us to the place that we need to be to promote his kingdom. So that's a little longer than what I wrote right there in that story. So this year in level 2 counselor training, like I said, focus is going to be on trauma, and let's just go ahead and move down to the page that says session 1, introduction to level 2. For those of you that didn't get this manual, I'll get it sent out to you. It helps me. I don't know the page number.
It's page 4.
Yep, it's page 4. There might be more than one page 4, though. So, so those of you that are online, if you don't have the manual, it would be wise to so that I don't forget and send it to you. So we're going to focus deeply on the process of counseling, and those of you that have been in level 2 already, it's going to be a lot of review, but I tell you what, I've been gaining so much from the new training that I'm going through that I'm going to be sharing as much of that as I can too. So there were a few that came this summer and I was sharing off the cup with them. So it'll be a lot of repetition, but I find it doesn't matter how many times you repeat it. It just goes deeper. Yeah. There's a lot more.
Yeah.
So marriage and family, cultural and ethical stuff. Anytime we have international people that visit, we like to have them share. And so sometimes your class schedule is going to change impromptu because we change and we flow with whatever the Lord is doing, and sometimes it's not the things that we plan. Tonight we're going to go over, we'll just review all of the requirements, we'll go over the schedule, anytime, hopefully time for question and answer, and for people to share, and then I'll review a little bit what we're going to be doing in the next class. It's telling my internet to come on screen. So let's go down to the DSM level 2-3 counselor training schedule. Oh, that's not showing my, oh my gosh, I'm sorry, I didn't look up there. It's not casting it. It's showing on mine. All right, those of you online, what are you seeing? Are you seeing the manual or no?
We're seeing the a search page where you can, where we're looking at the files for level 2, not the manual.
That is weird because that's not what's showing on my computer as I'm sharing. Sorry, guys. I'm gonna do a little bit of that. So sure to put this thing up. Just having that open should be enough for it to show up. So, now I can't get my Zoom to open back up. I promise we'll work on glitches as we go through the year here. For some reason, I can't get my Zoom to go again. Huh.
We'll go back to that file page.
It won't go back to my Zoom. It's showing down at the bottom, but when I click on it, it won't open.
Look at it.
Huh, that is just weird. There it is over there now. See, I'm trying to double this. Well, it's this right here. There goes. Okay, I got it back.
All right.
Now we'll try this.
Right, sharing again.
That document should be showing up on here, but it's not.
So maybe select here.
Yeah. But this is what I did before. That's what I did before. And it's just showing back.
Mm-hmm. No, it's coming. It's spinning. It's spinning over there. I don't know if it's spinning over there.
Yeah. See, it's not showing up over there.
Oh, that one, I'm not sure.
It worked perfect on Monday. Sorry, guys.
Press the time and the date, correct?
Yeah. I don't, yeah.
It won't, you can't double click it.
Yeah, she did. Yeah,
she's got it
open here. I've got it open.
What is it? Click stop for that little square.
I am. It's, if you look at my computer, the document, it's
being shared on my computer, but it's not.
That's spreading out.
I've never seen this. I know. This is just weird. Right?
Lance, where
are you? I mean, why is that not up
what's
there?
What's in the box? That
that's
the screen if you want to switch to it. Oh.
Okay. Oh, I see Kathy Scott's on with us now. We're trying to figure out, you can run the screen share, and it's not working. Okay. There. Wait. There it is! Oh, thank you, Jesus! This is what I thought you guys were looking at before when I was trying it, because it was showing up on my computer, but not on yours. Okay, so we're down here looking at the level of cancer training schedule.
Don't make sense.
Now it's making sense. So obviously, tonight is interruption. I got this. There we go. And so next week we're going to do the foundation of inner healing. And that is where we do like a case study of Peter and go through looking at how Jesus brought healing to Peter's soul. Because, you know, back when I started Elijah House Ministries and they did inner healing, I thought, you know, I don't want to do this if it's not in the Bible. I want to make sure that this is scriptural. And this is what the Lord led me to, was the life. And so you've got some handouts in your manual with a lot of scripture and an assignment for you to do before class next time of going through that kind of life study or life history of Peter in preparation for class. And we'll look at that in just a little bit. But Elsa Jane, one of the things that we're doing a little different this year is typically Elsa Jane would always come in and teach level one healing miracles in the level one class, but we didn't do any healing miracles in level two. Well, she started doing the parables and Bible stories, and so we're going to have her come in once a month in level two, three, and do the parables and Bible stories. We're going to be looking at developmental stages, mainly Erickson stages of development, and I have some new handouts that are different from last year that are good. Bonding and attachment. And then we have, we rescheduled intensive training three times now. And so at this point, it is October 2nd through the 4th. And we can have 50 people in here. We open up the walls with the COVID restrictions. And so we're inviting our center's directors and leaders first to see how many people we get in. Then we will open it up to other people. So more information will be coming out on that because we just really set the date for that yesterday. And then we always take the first class after intensive to recap and review for the people that weren't able to be here. That is just good for us to process what we saw, what we heard. Betty has already agreed to speak for us on the morning of intensive. We're going to have Jane Keohane come in and do some training on inner healing, as well as Vonda's going to come and do some teaching. Yeah. And it's been hard to get Vonda because she works in the evenings, and so we can't. She can't come and teach in our classes, so we're going to use her whenever we can with the intensive training. And then I have a couple other people, but I haven't talked to them yet, so I probably shouldn't announce it.
It'll all be recorded as well.
It will all be recorded as well. We will be Zooming it. Yeah. Dynamics of trauma, and so I'm going to go down through a number of the things that I've been learning in the somatic experiencing. It's basically learning the biology of trauma, and then I always like pulling in different
at any level. But it's about nervous system regulation. And so we're going to be talking a lot about that. Trauma and memory, how memory stores. Those of you that have been in this class are familiar with the pendulation titration model of counseling. I want Teresa to come in and do some teaching on sexual abuse, which obviously fits in the trauma category. And then right after Thanksgiving, we're going to do a class where we just practice. And we practice on each other. And I found that it worked really well putting people into breakout rooms on Zoom when I've done the training with somatic experiencing. Continuing with trauma into December, and then we'll finish up the year with one of the parables. What else do you want to do? And then this next year, I pretty much left it blank because, like I say, things change, and I just don't want to fill it in yet. So all we did put in the parables, and we're taking a break at spring, and we will finish up this term on May 27th. And I put in some of the other dates for the year down here at the bottom. Betty's New Testament Bible class is always the first 10 weeks of January. And it switches New Testament one year, Old Testament the next, and I think this year it is New Testament. And so it won't conflict with our class. It's on Wednesdays and we're on Thursdays. So if you want to go to the Bible classes, that would be awesome. But they also are going to be recorded. And so I love it. Like I said, Kylie said one day turnaround when we Zoom a class and record it, she gets it up the next day. GSM annual meeting is on February 20th, and that's always a day when we have any outgoing board members and we vote in new ones and have a nice dinner and usually a Harambe and auction, and it's just a fun night. And that's when Teresa basically gives the state of the ministry speech too, that we collect all of the annual reports for both our international U.S. centers and compile that into one big report and do an overview of it that night. There's a registration form in here for those of you that haven't officially signed up. It's nice to have the registration form that we can file and make sure that we get information to everybody. And then the next document is the GSM training requirements. And it's, you know, it's pretty much like our level one. And those of you in different centers might have a little bit different requirements than we do here, and that's okay. Obviously, class attendance. And if you miss classes, now you can watch videos, which we didn't have available before. But you can also, it's rich to get together with one of the other students and just go over their notes and what they learned too. Again, you're going to still be doing life histories, even though we don't teach on that per se in level two, because we've already done that through level one. You're still needing to practice. So that's in preparation for beginning to intern. And the dates that I have on there, due by, I put due by October, and that I missed because, well, these are just suggested dates. And it's to keep you on track so that you don't get way behind. If you turn in your stuff when it says on here, you're going to be relaxed and have it all done by the end of the year. And then one oral report on life histories. And what I like to do is at the beginning of each class, we'll just open it up. Does anybody have a book report? Does anybody have a life history that you want to share tonight? Okay. So it's your responsibility to raise your hand and say, I'm ready to do this, or I'd like to do that. Or those of you at a distance, you can email me beforehand and say, I'd like to share a life history tonight, or I'd like to share a book report with the class. And book reports are just very simple, just a few questions, because what I emphasize a lot in my level one class is any of the homework that you do is not for me. It's not for your teacher, it is for you. You're doing this so that you can learn, so that you can integrate whatever material it is that you're studying. And book reports, the reason I had you do those, I still look back to the book reports I wrote in when I was in training in the 90s. It's like, oh yeah, that's what that book was about. So they're good reminders. And the oral report on life history, I want you to go a little more in depth this time. It's like, okay, where would I go next with this person? What might a treatment plan be with them? What was the presenting problem? What did I see? So a little deeper than we did in level one. Any questions so far? And then the continued study of the healing miracles. There's 19 healing miracles that you'll be doing through, that have to finish by the time you're done with level three to graduate. And turn your healing miracles into Elsa Jane. And Elsa Jane did create just a one-page question thing to use with the parables. I'm not going to make that mandatory because it's brand new this year. But I highly encourage you to use it and to study the parables. Come prepared to class, having read the parable and answered those questions, and you'll get a whole lot more out of it. You're going to get out of it what you put into it. So we went over the book reports and then the Bible study classes. And I don't require that you attend all 10 classes. Some of you attended way more than that already, and you have those requirements completed. But I'd like you to choose at least 3 of them each year to engage in. And you can do that online, or you can come to class. And the intensive training, we talked a little bit about that. Each year, we usually have a spring intensive here, and then we usually do the fall intensive somewhere else at one of the other centers. But this year, we're doing it here because we have a spring one, thanks to COVID. And I usually have a summer level one training, too, and we didn't get to have that. This is a series. Counseling-related workshop or class, college class, and this is something that when I went through, we were required to take courses. So a lot of you have probably already had like psychology and some of those type of things, but psychology, sociology, anything that relates to the counseling process. Some of you may have been through drug and alcohol classes or whatever. But any workshops that you take outside, it's just something to help you broaden your perspective. We don't want people to get tunnel vision and think that GSM is the only place in the world that has answers. No. We want you to see what's out there. I encourage you to check out secular concepts and theories, and because you will learn something, and it may be, that doesn't work. Or it may be that, oh, that's why those people are doing that, because they've been learning this stuff, you know? So we need to know what's being taught out there and what people are learning. When they come into us and they say, I've been through this kind of therapy and that kind of therapy, and I've done lots of cognitive behavioral stuff, and I've been through this 12-step program, it's good for us to have some idea of what they've been through. Supervision. I want each of you to meet, you need to meet with a supervisor, like some of you have been meeting with Gordon Gross, is one of our supervisors here. But you also, and that's when you begin interning, that you will have a counselor supervisor that you meet with. But for class, you need to meet with me, or, you know, it might be Suzanne, or it might be one of our other people, because I have trouble keeping up with all of it. but it's just to go through that checklist and to look at, okay, here's where I'm at in the program. This is what I need to finish. You know, so it's not an evaluation of how good you're doing or not. It's just you being able to look at it with somebody else and say, okay, here's where I'm at. This is what I need to finish. And I'm good to go. Because I want to do a graduation at our intensive training. And we've got at least a couple of people that are ready to graduate that have already interned. The teacher training, I think most of you have been through the teacher training class, haven't you? Because we did it in level one. And so teacher training, for those of you online, we do it in a 5-week course. Some of you may offer it in Walla Walla and Tri-Cities, I'm not sure. But it's a powerful training. We're all teachers. What am I teaching? And when Sheila and I went through it, and a number of people from the Walla Walla, Pendleton, Tri-Cities area, we came to Beaverton once a month for a year. And it was hell or high water. It didn't matter what the roads were, man, we were going to be here. And we learned so much from it. And so through the years, and you know, Elsa Jane has been one of the teachers, and so we condensed it into a 5-week class, and so I usually do that in the spring in level one. And so if you haven't been through it, you can always come to level one class on the 5 weeks that we teacher training. And then summer practicum. Those that were in summer practicum this year, what did you think of it?
Sure. Really great, yeah.
Yeah, share a little bit about what we did. What was summer practicum like?
Well, we practiced some of the things that we were taught, and we actually got to physically see some of the well, I guess I could use me for an example, is when I went through a car accident. And we went through that whole process. And so that was able to help me be able to work with somebody else, you know, starting from the beginning of it, or before the accident even happened, and then what happened during and what happened after.
Yeah. So it was a close, intimate class this summer because of COVID, and there were very few of us that were able to come in, and I wasn't willing to Zoom it because it is very intimate because we're actually counseling. We're working with each other.
We're role-playing.
Role-playing, and yet you'll probably find out anytime that you role-play, your own stuff always gets in there somehow. It's a subconscious thing, and it's a good thing, you know. We end up working on some real stuff. Personal counseling is a requirement. If you're going to be a counselor, you got to be counseled. You got to know what it's like to sit on the inside of the chair. And I have a minimum, a random number I pick, because most of us need, you know, 6 years, not 6 sessions. But I figure, by just putting a number in there, you'll start counseling and you'll know how much, you know, you'll know I need to keep going. Or, you know, I found myself through the years, I would counsel for a while, then I'd take a break and go live in what I had just experienced, what I'd been healed from. And then I'd get triggered by something else and I'd go back and get some more. And I think that's just the way we are, because we continue. Just because we've been counseled doesn't mean life's traumas stop. Life keeps happening. And it brings up stuff that we'll go, dang, I thought I finished that. And something that is important in level two is to be able to go and observe other people counseling. Here in Beaverton, we have the advantage of usually a lot of counselors here, of course, with COVID, a lot of them in counseling online. But to be able to sit in and observe with the counselors and the client's permission, but you just kind of become part of the wall and silently watch and see what you observe. And you'll see there's an observation form in here. And what you do is you go over that form before you go in so that you got in mind what's on the form, because a counseling session is not going to go in the order that those questions are on the form. But it's good for you to see a variety, to sit in on several different counselors, so you can see that there's totally different styles, even though we all use a lot of the same concepts. We do have a number of interns here, and you can't go in and observe the interns because of their college regulations that allow that. But I really want you, it would be nice for you to be able to observe, even if you observe somebody outside of GSM, and you could get that comparison of what it's like with a licensed professional counselor versus somebody who's GSM trained, you know? So those are things that you, here, you just, you arrange it with the counselor, you go to the front desk, you find out who's available, you talk to the counselor the next form is just a checklist to keep track. This is what you would bring to a supervision meeting. To say, I've gone to this many classes in the fall, that many in the winter and spring. I went to this many Bible studies, blah, blah, blah. The dates that you did your, the life histories and completed them, any healing miracle studies you've done, book reports, the supervision that you would have your supervisor, whoever met with you, sign off on that. The observations are on here. And then other classes or workshops or groups that you've attended. Any questions yet?
It's called Adult Children of Emotionally Immature Parents, and since you grew up with emotionally immature parents, I wondered if you were familiar with that.
I have a sitting on my coffee table.
Oh, okay. It's the better books I've ever read about.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you have read it.
Yeah. It's okay. Very, very good.
Okay.
And very right on. For my kids, I was raised with teen parents.
Oh.
They were drug addicts, so they were pretty. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And so that's an example, guys, of if you have, you know, I have a recommended reading list, and that's just because those are books I've read. If you've read something that you think should go on that list, just send it to me through email. Oh, and by the way, Carlos just created a new email for us. It's called training@gsmusa.org. And so any homework that you would submit online, that's where we want it submitted, is into that training@gsmusa.org. And I'll be sending that out. I haven't even had a chance to look at it yet. I'm too crazy busy. But that way, when your homework or whatever comes in, we can put it right into a digital file and help keep track of stuff.
Just on one more note, there's a lot of YouTube with her as well. The author.
Oh,
it's always good. So to see.
Thank you.
And there's this app, the next thing that says GSM Volunteer Counselor Training Application. This is something that we used to have people fill out at the beginning of level one to even come into the counselor training program, But those of us rebels over on the other side of the state, Walla Walla, Tri-Cities, Pendleton, we all decided to change level one to open it to anybody and call it personal ministry training so that people could do level one and use it wherever and not feel obligated to go on to be a counselor if they didn't really want to be a counselor. Because there's a lot of healing that takes place in level one, and there's so much you can learn just about ministering, you know. So at level two, sometime, I would like before the end of the year, if you have not filled out this, or you don't actually fill out this form, it just tells you what to do. So it's a resume, a summary of your personal history, your spiritual background. So it's a story about you, your objectives in the program, occupational objectives, and then personal recommendations.
I thought we filled one out before.
I did. Yes. Yeah, you did. That's what I'm saying. If you haven't done this, to do it. But some people have, and you did this. And it's just something that we want to keep on file, and we do have to. We're required to do background checks on your community counseling. And then this next one is the observation form that I said you would use when you sit in and watch somebody else counseling. So you'd read down through this, who's in charge of the session? Who's doing the talking? And this is all just your perspective. There's no wrong answers. What did you observe? It's for you to see, oh, that was really good, or oh, wow, I wouldn't have done it that like that, or I'd ask a different question or whatever. You know, you can't get it wrong. And you're not going to share it necessarily with the counselor. You're going to share it with your supervisor. So here's what I learned by observing this person.
So do you write this after you come out of the session?
Yeah, after you just take notes.
While you're in it, right?
No, you just take notes along these lines. That's why I say familiarize yourself with the form, the questions that are asked. And then write it up after you have done the observation. You can take notes during the session.
You know what you're kind of looking for.
And you can have that there in front of you so that you can refer to it. And then the next one is that recommended reading list. And this is not exhaustive. It's just that I want to give you some ideas of what to read. And you can read things outside of this as long as it has, you know, something to do with counseling. Dave, have you ever read any of Bridget Cantrell's work? Down Range, The Rack and Back, some of those?
I have not yet. Oh. I believe I have Once a Warrior Wired for Life. I have that and haven't started it yet.
Well, I would love to hear your perspective on it when you get to that.
Certainly.
Then the book report form, that's just to show you that it's very simple. It's not, you don't like rewrite the book. And then this next one is the assignment for next week, preparation for session two, The Life of Peter. And so up at the top, I have bulleted what some things for you to look for and questions to ask her. Ask yourself as you read each one of these. So what's the physical setting and the sensory input? So say, for instance, Peter is on the Sea of Galilee. That's where Capernaum is. What are some, and he's a fisherman. What are some of the sights, smells, and sounds that he might hear as a fisherman on the Sea of Galilee? Come on, guys, it's not a trick question.
The smell of fish.
The smell of fish, yay, yeah.
Smell of sticky man.
Smell of the sweat, yeah.
On a boat.
Uh-huh. The water has a smell.
Mm-hmm. And the sensory, the movement.
Yep, the movement of the boat, of the waves.
Other fishermen and boats.
What was that?
Other fishermen and boats.
Other fishermen and boats, yeah, the visual of that.
I was thinking of the gruffness of other voices.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes they have very colorful language.
Yeah, I hear some colorful language among the fishermen. Yeah, so that's kind of the idea, and as we study trauma, you'll begin to understand why I'm having you examine these things. This is going to be a year of learning of both yourself and your surroundings. So what physical sensations and emotions might Peter be experiencing in each one of these? You know, by physical sensations, we'll work a lot on that this year, of you getting in touch with your own physical sensations. And by physical sensations, I'm talking about touch, smell, what's going on inside of me. Is my stomach growling? Do I have like a, kind of an electric feeling? Is my heart beating fast? Is my breath shallow? Where are the aches and pains? You know, a fisherman pulling in nets, what's he going to be feeling in his body? So, and then what does scripture reveal about Peter's character or personality? I think his personality shows up more than any of the other disciples. So what did you see in the scripture about that? So then I just went through and kind of put some bullet points on most of these. I didn't on the feeding of the 5,000, but you get the idea. So I gave a number of examples. This is by no means exhaustive. There's a lot more scripture about Peter, but I wanted to give kind of a sensory overview of Peter and who he is and what his life's about in preparation for the foundation of inner healing class that we will be doing. Next. And then the rest of this, you'll see Suzanne put a page in here in preparation for session three, and it's just a nice page that you can take some notes on as you read through the parable in preparation for Elsa Jane's class. And like I say, this is something new. She just started doing the parables this last year, and she loved it. She said she learned so much. And so that's why we decided to incorporate it in our level three class. And one of the things that we'll be looking at is how does being a counselor, what's that got to do with me here? And then at the end of this page, I put down the assignment for the next one. And the Erickson's developmental stages is not in your manuals yet, but you will have a handout for that before that class so that you can go through it before the class. And then there's a table here that has a list of the parables and their scriptural references and the dates that we'll be doing them there for June. And then this is the one-page worksheet that Elsa Jane put together. I haven't used it yet, but she's got some good questions on there. She said she was still kind of playing with it, too. She might change it some, but so we're all kind of guinea pigs this year with Elsa Jane's new class. But I love Elsa Jane. She was such a deep, deep teacher. And this, you already have the index of the healing miracles and the healing miracles study forms. We just put them in here again so that you would have them available. Some of you at a distance may not have these, but it is the foundation of our training. The last part of that, the one that says summary, know that you can ignore that until you're all done with all of the miracles, and that's when you fill out as a summary of all of the 19 healing miracles. So there you have it. That's how much we have done in the manual, and it will hold as we continue the class. Any questions so far? Those are the requirements for this level. Boy. Must be very clear. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to unshare this.
So how soon will those of us who didn't get the handbook get it?
Well, I'll try to send it. I'll send it out right after class tonight. But I don't have your email. I've got to have your email to send it. So that's why any of you that don't have the manual, make sure you send me your name and email and request for the manual. Okay.
A little delayed with the holidays.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'll try to get it out before I leave tomorrow.
Cindy, I think that Ruth Ann and my email was in an email from Angie.
Oh, okay. But it'd be nice if you sent it again, because it's probably buried in my emails by now. That's why we're going to switch over to the training email, so that I don't bury them and lose them. So who do we have here? Is it Sunny? That's online? Any other questions about the requirements? Yes, yeah, for those of you in the class that are in that hour. Yeah. Okay, so there, you know, there really, tonight there wasn't much teaching or training to really give thoughts on, but anybody have anything you want to share? Just, we're going to end early tonight because this was just kind of an introductory night, and next time we will typically go from 6 o'clock until 8:30. And I want to encourage you to take care of yourselves. You can take a break at any time that you want. Get up, move around. Most classes will be doing some exercises where we do that. I told the level one class, I'm always hesitant to give breaks because it's hard to get people back from the breaks. But sometimes we do. We need a 10-minute break or so somewhere in the middle. But tonight we're going to end a little bit early. So what, anybody have thoughts, takeaways you want to share before we close tonight?
I'm just thinking how different this is, and yet what a profound opportunity that God has given us. You know, we didn't anticipate COVID-19 being so obnoxious, and yet bringing us to a new level of understanding technology and utilizing it for His kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
That's powerful.
Yeah.
I'm very excited about it.
Yeah.
Even though it's strange.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very excited.
That's drawing in people from all over.
That's right.
That we wouldn't have had before.
Wonderful.
Yes. You know, there are some things that we can be grateful for. And we can, what it is we can be grateful that God can use every circumstance. And I believe that this type of thing is what God is doing among us, is that we would not be Zooming and videoing all of this stuff if it weren't for COVID. And it's mainly because you have some old directors. Teresa was more resistant to it than me, even. But the Lord's bringing it into our comfort zone. And we have been able to include people from faraway places that we've never been able to do yet. We're very grateful for that. Yeah, that's a good idea that I need to have the permission from each of you if you're willing to have your email shared with the rest of the class. And I'll try to remember and put that in an email out to you and have you share it back to me. Or maybe send out a survey to you or something.
We could put our emails in chat.
Oh yeah, that's true. We do have the chat feature on Zoom. But it'd be nice to put it into one document and I can have Kylie or Laura do that for me. I do. You have some assistance now, finally, to help me with this. But I've got to get used to handing things over because I'm so used to doing it all myself.
You put it on a note there for you. It's sort of in the note passing around for this group. Okay.
But anyway, you wanted. And so I do have a list of most everybody's emails. Is there anybody online that would really, I guess everybody that would like to have your name on an email list, give a thumbs up. Because you can work with each other to do life histories. Or if there's anybody that really doesn't want to be on the list, let me know. So I see pretty much all thumbs up. So. And I'm not sure who we have here with Sunny. It's not showing up. Changed it. Change this to gallery view.
Oh, there you go.
I think he just left.
Oh, okay. Darn. There was somebody.
It did say Sunny.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't have much light around him, so hard to tell what he looked like.
I'm not sure. And you know, you okay, so Lorna's got hers on chat, but I do have yours on the list. It's just those, a couple of you that I didn't have registered that I need your emails.
Oh, that's us.
Yeah, you've been on there all the time.
I just send my registration through your email.
Okay, yeah. Okay, anything that anybody wants to share before we close tonight? There's somebody that wants to, that would volunteer to close us in prayer?
I can close us in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we were able to come together tonight. Father God, I thank you that we have the ability to come together. When we are gathered, our spirits can connect no matter the distance or mileage between us. So we can come together and we can share and connect as we've come together to both seek healing and to seek out how to heal your people, Father God, through your guidance. We thank you, Father God. We thank you for the hands that have labored over this training and the hands that have prepared it and the many years and decades of experience that have come together to train us, that we do not have to start where Betty started so many years ago, that such a great foundation has been built for us to go off of. I thank you for this time, Father God. I pray, Father God, your protection and safety over everyone, both online and those who have to travel back home from the office there. We pray your continued blessing over this time as we come together. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dave. Actually,